We're living on a planet facing almost insurmountable challenges. Challenges we have to face sooner rather than later. The world needs our energy. She needs our ideas, our passion. It's up to us to change things, make a positive change to the planet, to feed the world, to protect the future, to live well, to be the generation that will make a change. Join us.
Hello. My name is Jamie Thompson and I'm the Acting Director of Student Engagement, and it's my job to welcome you here tonight. This event is basically part of our Changemakers series, and it's called Tomorrow's Changemakers, and it's proudly brought to you today by our Global Challenges Scholars. It's actually very fitting because today is the 45th birthday of Greenpeace and it's also Conservation Week. We didn't plan that, it just happened like that, but we're pretty happy. This inaugural event has been almost a year in the planning, and I know our students are really, really excited to share the culmination of a whole lot of hard work with you. Now, I've got the fun job of telling you about health and safety. So, a few pieces of advice. In the unlikely event of an emergency, please vacate the theatre. Now, you'll notice there's an exit in the door you came in, and there's also two exits at the back. So, take the one which is closest to you. When you leave, please assemble on the grass outside. In case of an earthquake, please do the usual drop, cover and hold, and look to the friendly staff members at the front of the room and we'll tell you what to do. Toilets are located out the back under the stairs, basically on the ground floor. And of course, to give the scholars a peace of mind, please turn your cell phones off. That's really important. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce the MC of the evening, Dr. Tim Curran. Tim is a senior lecturer in ecology here at Lincoln, and his expertise are in plant functional ecology, restoration ecology, evolutionary ecology, biogeography, and wildlife management. Some of his specific projects have included understanding how New Zealand plants respond to fire, identifying traits associated with plant response to drought, frost, and cyclones, and using traits to assemble ecological communities that are resistant and resilient to global change. Tim has also been a very prominent advocate and mentor of the Global Challenges Scholars since the commencement of the scholarship almost 2 years ago. Personally, I don't think we could get a better qualified MC if we tried. Thanks, Tim.
Thanks, Jamie, and welcome here tonight. I guess my research that I've been doing lately could be best summed up by the fact that I'm very good at either making plants die or watching them die. So I guess what this means is I'm not a very good person for you guys to ask me to look after your plants if you go away on holidays. So here at Lincoln University, we're on a mission to feed the world, protect the future, and live well. In 2050, we're expecting that there'll be 9 billion people inhabiting our planet, and this is going to lead to a wide range of challenges. These challenges include things like climate change, shortages in food, as well as problems with food security, issues with food production, habitat loss, biodiversity loss, and increased pollution. The young people that you're going to see tonight are our Global Challenge Scholars, and they've been on their own mission this year, which is designed to transform passionate young people into cooperative, informed social entrepreneurs. Our scholars have been undertaking their own social entrepreneurship and enterprise projects since February. They've taken part in a development program designed to inform them about the principles of social entrepreneurship through techniques such as design thinking, problem solving, collaboration, research, and critical thinking. And these are all skills that are going to serve them well no matter what they do with the rest of their lives. They've also had a range of wonderful mentors on their specific projects who have been able to help them on their journey. So their aim has been to identify challenges in their local communities or their local area which are applicable on a global scale and then develop methods to either mitigate or solve these challenges through creating a positive impact. Alongside this, They've also developed into passionate global citizens who want to make a positive impact on the world that they live in and become tomorrow's change makers. And I think they've done an excellent job of that, as you'll see very, very shortly. So on one hand, we've got our scholars, and they're ultimately the most important people in the room today. But we've also got three other people that are almost equally as important, and that's our three judges. So first of all, we've got Nazman Ratnar. Now, Nazman is a senior lecturer here in Lincoln University whose research and expertise focuses on agricultural development, female empowerment, and developing economies in Southeast Asian countries. Nazman is currently involved in a food, energy, environment, water network project around sustainable intensification of agriculture and resilient food systems in the eastern Indo-Gangetic Plains. Next, we've got Anna Gunther. Anna is the co-founder of Pledge Me in New Zealand, and is doing so has raised over $12 million for community and entrepreneurial projects. She also has a master's degree in social entrepreneurship. And finally, we've got Jason Pemberton. Jason is a social entrepreneur who has more than 10 years' experience. He was a core leader of the Student Volunteer Army Foundation until 2014, and since then has expanded his repertoire into music performance, as well as inspirational and motivational public speaking. So I'm sure a number of you in the audience are asking yourselves, what is social entrepreneurship? Well, perhaps the best thing we can do is actually ask an expert. So I'd now like to call on one of our judges, Anna Gunther, to come down and explain it to us. Please welcome Anna.
I had to have a little laugh when I got asked to come and present on this because my master's is in entrepreneurship, not social entrepreneurship, but I do try to count myself as a social entrepreneur. But a few years ago, I actually wrote a blog post about social entrepreneurship with the title of What the Fuck is Social Enterprise? Because it's something that we debate about a lot in New Zealand and actually internationally, the definition of social enterprise. So I'm going to quickly run through some of my thinking with you, and I'll try not to swear anywhere near as much as I normally do. But yeah, my name is Anna Gunther, and I'm the co-founder of Pledge Me. It's a crowdfunding platform here in New Zealand, and our mission is to help Kiwis fund the things they care about. So basically, we're trying to democratize capital. And so we think we're a social enterprise. Social enterprise, simply put, is the idea that your organization has a very clear social or environmental impact, and you have a commercial arm, so you're self-sustaining in the work that you do. There's a few ways that this can come about. You can be a startup, like we are. You can be a community-owned enterprise or a co-op. In fact, the first social enterprise that they think existed was in the 1870s. It was a co-op in the UK. You can be a not-for-profit that has a commercial arm underneath you, sort of like the Cancer Society with the sunscreen that they sell. Or you can be a corporate who actually either creates a social enterprise arm or partners and creates a joint venture. For example, I don't know if you know Danone, the yogurt company. They partnered with the Grameen Bank to try to sell high nutrition yogurt into street kids. So I'm just going to quickly run through two more local examples to give you an idea of how social enterprise actually works in practice. And social enterprise, the thing I love about it is it's diverse. I think that they've said almost half of the social enterprises that we see are founded and run by women, which just sounds like it's the way it should be. But when you look into the more startup space or corporates in general, only 7% of venture capital funding in the States goes to companies with a female founder, and only 0.5% to companies with a female CEO. So it's great to see what social enterprise is doing. And one example is Brianne West, who is from here in Christchurch. Do any of you know Brianne? Brianne's not in the room, is she? No. Brianne started a company called Ethique, and she creates solid hair care bars. So basically, they're solid shampoos. And the idea is you don't need water in your shampoo if you're about to walk into a room filled with water. And by creating these solid hair care bars, she's stopped over 100,000 bottles from going to landfill so far. So she's reducing waste. She's also not testing her product on animals. And she actually gives part of her profit to animal rights groups around New Zealand. And the cool thing with Brianne is when she wanted to go out and raise money, she crowdfunded. And she had over $200,000 raised in 2 weeks. And 80% of the people that invested in her were current customers. So they just loved what she did. Another example from Auckland is a company called Eat My Lunch. I'm not sure if you've heard of them, but they are a company that does a buy one, gift one model. If you buy a lunch from them, they gift a lunch to a child who didn't take lunch that day to school. And their reason for doing that is because 31% of New Zealand children live in poverty, and which is scary to that that's even a thing. But they think that if they can feed these kids, they can get a better education, and they can actually change that cycle. And so in the last year, they've only been going for a year, they've gifted over 250,000 lunches to kids in need. And the thing about social enterprise is it is all about that impact. You need to be able to clearly define the impact that you want to have and be able to show that you're having it. So with them, they're able to say that they've already gifted 250,000 lunches to kids in need. And they're sustainable because they're also selling lunches. So that's social enterprise sort of super quickly. Do you all now know what social enterprise is? There's a few nods in the room. Cool. Awesome.
Thank you very much. Thanks for that, Anna. As you can see in the program, we've got 12 changemaker groups over here waiting to do their presentations. Their presentations will each go for 5 minutes, and they'll describe their project aims, what they hope to achieve with their projects, and where to from here. After each group is presented, we'll have time for one question from one of the judges. Okay, so they're already prepped on this and are fighting it out as to who gets to ask those questions. And then we'll move on to the next group. Now, we're going to do 6 teams first up, and then we'll have a 5-minute break to give everyone a chance to stretch their legs, and there will also be prizes as part of that break, okay? So we're not leaving you empty-handed during those 5 minutes. And then we're going to listen to the final 6 teams. So what you should do is listen very carefully to what these teams have to say, because once all of them have given their presentations, this is then your opportunity to have interactions with them. Now, on your entry forms, you should all have a small token. That is your opportunity to vote for the People's Choice Awards. So what's going to happen after all the 12 teams have finished, they're going to proceed out into the foyer where they're going to stand with their posters, and we'll field questions that anyone has to ask. Everyone's going to be provided with a free drink as you do that to lubricate the conversations with our change makers. And during that time, the judges will be conferring, and then we'll come back in here, work out the People's Choice Award, and also announce the prizes. And the prizes are pretty spectacular ones. There's 2 prizes that we're offering tonight. The first of all is the overall winners are going to go on a trip, all expenses paid, to Sydney, where they're going to spend 2 days at mentoring workshops with other incredible social entrepreneurs. Okay, so they get a wonderful chance to further their ideas. And the People's Choice Award will get a trip up to Wellington for the day and workshop sessions in Wellington led by Anna. So thanks very much to Anna for offering that that kind service for our People's Choice Award. Okay, we're on to the main event now. So without any further ado, I'd like to introduce the very first group, which is called Eat Ugly.
"21,000 people die every day due to hunger or hunger-related causes. This is one person every 4 seconds. One person. 2 people. 3 people. Sadly, it is children who die the most often. Yet we produce enough food to feed everyone. 45% of fruit and veg is wasted. Half of this is wasted due to agriculture, due to consumers and supermarkets' high standards. Essentially because they are claimed to be ugly."
So we are Eat Ugly. I'm Ben, this is Laura and Emily. So we needed a solution. We needed to come up with a way to produce, to get this length of produce that doesn't meet industry standard to the people who need the fruit and veg but can't afford it. There's currently a huge amount of perfectly good food that is slightly blemished or misshaped that is going to waste and just going to pigs because it's convenient for farmers when there is not enough people getting enough fruit and vegetables. If we could do this, then we'd be reducing food waste by putting the produce to the people who need it the most, alleviating poverty by providing fresh produce to people who cannot afford it and need it, and promoting healthy eating. It took quite a while to come up with an idea, but as they say, all good things take time. Our awesome mentor, Ben, from Fill Their Lunchbox, which is a local social enterprise here in Christchurch, is gathering huge momentum at the moment. He sparked an idea with us to get more fresh produce options into low-income areas, as all you see is fast food chains and no discount fresh produce options in there. Laura then read an article on Stuff about how Canterbury students were going to the Christchurch City Mission to get food because they couldn't afford a decent meal. We saw this as a real opportunity to make a difference, and so we thought we'd start small here in Lincoln with a pilot. So our idea is to buy ugly produce from farmers, which are so far quite interested to help us, and sell it to students. We would then be making this use of this previously wasted food, promoting healthy eating to students, as it would be a much more affordable source of vegetables for them. Also, this would require very little funding to start up, as we have a strong following on Facebook, so won't need to spend too much on marketing, and we won't need much capital as it's quite a low cost setup. We would make a margin on our sales, which would cover our costs, and then we'd reinvest back into the business, making it a sustainable model with a social impact. From our research, students spend on average $60 per week on food. Also, we found that 70% of students spend less than $20 a week on fruit and vegetables. The highlight of the survey, however, was that 87% of students would buy ugly produce off us at a discounted rate on campus. We can then use the same model in low-income areas where we can provide a similar service.
So the future here at Eat Ugly is a really exciting one. Once we have developed our brand and built awareness of the issue and have made progress with our pilot here at the university campus, we plan to expand our locations in the Greater Selwyn and Canterbury area. This will diversify our audience and enable us to make a significant impact in low-income areas, providing a cheap alternative to healthy food, therefore promoting healthy eating and alleviating poverty and reducing food waste. We have also had a very generous offer from Ben, our mentor at Fill Their Lunchbox, to use his commercial kitchen. This would enable us to create our own Eat Ugly product line using the really, really ugly food. The products we're thinking of at the moment are soups, stocks, chips and juices. We would then sell these products at our market stalls and hopefully one day in the supermarkets. This would create a great cycle of using potentially wasted food and turning it into delicious edible products. At the beginning of our Eat Ugly journey, despite not knowing exactly what we were going to do, we all agreed that we wanted to push for policy change. Therefore, once we have continued to grow our audience and customer base, we will strive for policy change to see ugly fruit and vegetables in supermarkets rather than going to waste. To finish, I invite you all to like our Facebook page, Eat Ugly. And remember, 75 people have died during the duration of the speech due to hunger-related issues, and many of these would have been preventable if we all chose to eat ugly. Thank you.
So what are your plans around expanding both here in Christchurch and around New Zealand? What are the next steps and how do you plan on doing that?
So what we wanted to do, so Ben, who's from Fill Their Lunchbox, his original sort of spark to us was to start little market stands in areas that need this sort of service. So if we can start there, basically, because we want to be a sustainable business model, we want to be able to fund ourselves. Our main goal, because he's offered the use of his commercial kitchen, is to get our own product line. So that would be turning these fruit and vegetables into soups, stocks, that sort of thing. And so we want to fund that with what we do in our market stalls, basically. Yeah. Starting small, building our way up.
Excellent. Thanks very much.
Our next group is a Dr. Waterway.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Bailey Kirsten. Today I have here with me my co-founders, Dylan and Imogen, and together we are Adopt a Waterway. So firstly, let's get to the gritty business. New Zealand's water quality, because here in New Zealand, we are gifted with some of the most amazing waterways in the world, such as this prime example up on my slide. But, yes, there's a but. After a bit of this and that, which we collectively know as pollution, these waterways are starting to look a lot more like my picture on the next slide. So why is New Zealand water quality in decline? Well, firstly, reduction in wetlands, because wetlands are nature's natural filter systems. Secondly, intensified agriculture typically means more fertiliser and more stock, this resulting in more leaching, more runoff, and more effluent, all ending up in our waterways. Urban and industrial waste comes in many forms. The one that sticks out to me, coming from the West Coast, is acid mine leaching. This is when material is brought from a reduced environment, which is underground, to the surface where it's oxidised. Then it leaches out from the tailings and ends up in our waterways, giving it a funny orange colour and decreasing the water quality. Lastly, reduction in water quantity. Because as the Americans say, the solution to pollution is dilution. And in drier regions like here in Canterbury, we don't have much water to start with. So when we then go take some out for irrigation, it does not take much chemical or nutrients to hit toxic levels. But anyway, that's enough of me bagging the farmers and everyone else, because here at Lincoln University, we're all about solutions. So now I'm going to hand you over to Dylan Imogen to tell you guys how we got from looking at this ugly issue to standing in front of a bunch of good-looking people.
Earliest records state that New Zealand had 80% native vegetation in its natural state. It enjoyed high levels of biodiversity and enviable water quality. This has now dropped to an astonishing low 30%, as you can see on these slides. Deforestation is devastation. Our mission is to protect the delicate and already challenged environment and all of the species that live within it. Enthuse, inspire and educate through community activities and working with schools. To connect passionate Kiwis who are interested about protecting the environment and who are willing to stand up and make a change. People like you. Make a long-lasting difference by creating sanctuaries for our diverse life, by creating bird boxes, removing waterway barriers, undertaking planting and much more. Empowering guardians for New Zealand's unheard voices who struggle for survival every day in a place where they should thrive. We had so many ideas that it was hard to come up with one that we could target. So each idea was one part of the jigsaw to make the whole solution. First, we thought of plant donations. We would get one plant donated to us for everyone that was purchased at a nursery. With whitebait population decreasing, we then thought of a quota, but the main issue was habitat loss, and there are many groups that are addressing this already. Aiding farmers to decrease pollution by managing their resources more efficiently was our next thought. We would do this by having easy monitoring systems. I'll now hand you over to Imogen, who will tell you why Adopt a Waterway was the baby that we adopted.
Cheers, Dylan. We soon realised that there's no way that any one of these solutions was going to help us overcome the challenges facing New Zealand's waterways. So we decided to incorporate them all, and that's how Adopt a Waterway was born. Since its birth, we've come up with many strong connections, all of which have agreed to support us in achieving our mission. Our first action is to educate the future generations. We aim to get local schools adopting their local waterways so that their kids can learn about the importance of water quality and actively contribute to improving it. This will be done through environmental assessment and management, with the aim that these kids will be able to tell their kids about how they played a significant role in improving New Zealand's water quality. The first school lucky enough to be a part of Adopt a Waterway is Lincoln Primary. On October the 18th, we'll be joining them as part of their planting day down at the Aotearoa River. There, we'll be running an activity, asking them to assess the water quality and how they could improve it before encouraging them to follow through. But why should we stop there? Here at Adopt a Waterway, we plan to expand out of Lincoln and up to adults with individual, business, and group adoptions. We aim to prove ourselves as an organisation before we try and take on the big leagues as a social enterprise, contracted to the likes of DOC, regional councils, farmers, landowners, you name it. We're going to be the guys that they're going to call when they have a waterway that isn't up to scratch. For now, though, we can plan to continue building on our relationship with EnviroSchools, providing the education and the resources to the community, because we believe that this is the first step on our journey to making a change. I'll now hand back over to Bailey.
Thank you, Imogen. Yes, we are free, passionate people, but free people can only do so much. This is when you get involved, because our goal is to make Adopt a Waterway a network of passionate, enthusiastic environmentalists who want to make New Zealand waterways great again. If you ain't no gardener, don't let that put you off, because not all water quality issues can be solved by repairing and plantings. We especially will need the assistance of lawyers and businessmen as we fight to safeguard our waterways for future generations. So if this sounds like you, or you've got a question, come have a chat to us at our stand or get in touch with us on Facebook. Thank you.
Hey, awesome guys. Yeah, hugely important issue. Awesome to see you guys looking at it. I'm interested, you talked about having a few partners that you're looking at engaging with. You've obviously talked to quite a few people. How's the response been? What's it been like engaging with these groups?
We've had a lot to do with EnviroSchools recently, and we are working with them to do that planting day, but we've also discussed meeting with them over summer to plan all of next year and making sure we have a large role. We also have Waterwatch. They are an organisation that get mainly high school students out on the waterways testing in that. So they have a lot of knowledge and resources they can provide, and they have a lot of equipment. So we pretty much are just being the middlemen and trying to build an army that is going to change water quality for the better.
Please thank them up for the waterway.
Our next group is Roots for Recreation.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jan Booter, and I'm part of Roots for Recreation. Along with my colleagues here, Sophie and Taylor, we have chosen also to focus on water quality. Yeah, that's hello. Water quality is a huge concern worldwide. For example, the Aral Sea. The Aral Sea used to be the fourth largest lake in the world and is now a fraction of that size. This is due to two of its major rivers, which water comes from, being diverted for irrigation for cotton fields. Looking closer to home, we have Lake Forsyth in our backyard. Lake Forsyth is always sitting there as a constant reminder to us how bad water quality can get. Similar calls have been made about the decreasing water quality of Lake Ellesmere. Recently, farmers have been receiving the majority of flak for the decreasing water quality here in the Southern District. Roots for Recreation agrees that water quality should not be decreasing. We agree that we need to be able to swim in our waterways and that our children should not be getting sick from the water that they're swimming in. However, we believe that we should be helping farmers rather than just giving them flak. Therefore, our idea is to have riparian planting. Riparian planting is one of many ways in which we can solve water quality. Riparian planting is where you plant plants along the bank of a stream or river to protect it from erosion or sediment loss. It is also helpful for buffering fecal matter during high rainfall events from entering the water, the waterways. However, riparian planting is very expensive. According to Christchurch City Council, it costs $30 to $1,000 per metre, depending on the terrain. Now, for most farmers, this is far too expensive for them, and they cannot afford to do this. So we would like to create the financial link for them to be able to carry out riparian planting on their property. The way that we would like to achieve this is by connecting the city to the farm. Through surveys that we have done, we have found out that there are many people within the urban environment who care passionately about their environment. They are willing to donate, give up of their time to help out environmental projects such as riparian planting. We have discovered that many of them lack the connection from the city to the urban to the rural environment. Therefore, we would like to act as that middleman between the two to connect the two people together. The way that we're going to do this is by creating a platform where farmers can share their stories on social media. People living within the city can then access that platform or a website and donate to the cause that they would like to choose. We would like to keep the sponsor involved in this process, so we are planning on creating a system where they are updated with how the plantings are going and how the seedlings' growth is going until they have reached full maturation, therefore keeping them in contact and involved throughout the entire time. As we were exploring options with farmers who we could possibly work with, we were told about the Million Metre Streams Project. Million Metre Streams Project is an Auckland-based group who currently has a platform, which is exactly what we're trying to propose to you here today. As you can imagine, that was quite a setback for us. However, talking to them, we quickly realised that they have limited access into the South Island. From the very beginning, we agreed together as Roots for Recreation that we should not go into competition with Million Metre Streams Project, who share very similar goals and visions of what we do. So currently we're exploring partnership opportunities where we can work with Million Metre Streams Project to get them here into the South Island. Ideally, we would like to see ourselves as the face of Million Metre Streams Project here in the South Island and act as a middleman for them and the community that surrounds us here. So if you think you can help us in any manner through the process of creating a partnership like this, please feel free to come and talk to us afterwards, email me or like us on Facebook. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you for your excellent presentation. You mentioned about the survey that you conducted among the urban. Tell a bit about the survey that you have. Whom did you talk to?
Yeah, so we emailed out the survey and we got a lot of responses, just asking whether people would be interested in getting involved with the planting process and how much money they'd be interested in donating. We also know that the people are interested in helping through the new, Christchurch City Council does a lot of planting days like this, so the process has worked before. Also, Trees for Canterbury organises things like this too. Yeah, so people are definitely interested in the idea.
Okay, thank you very much.
Our next group is Count Your Chickens.
$872 million. That, ladies and gentlemen, is New Zealand's food waste secret. I'm not sure if many of you know, but this is the value of food that is thrown away by New Zealand consumers every single year. What does this look like in quantity? As a matter of fact, it is 120,000 tonnes of food, or $563 worth of food per family per year. Hi. I'm Mitch Walting, and we here at Count Your Chickens want to change those figures. The domestic and global problem of food waste is not only causing financial loss, but more importantly, environmental loss. F- Food waste causes carbon emissions upwards of 320,000 tonnes, just for little old New Zealand. Imagine what our bigger, less skillful rugby playing neighbours are doing. We put a huge amount of resources into the creation of food, yet 30 to 50% of this food created is not even consumed. However, we still have people experiencing hunger on our planet. This photo up on the screen here represents the global challenge of food waste occurring at a local level. Springston Primary School, just down the road here, in conjunction with Enviro Schools Canterbury, kindly allowed us to carry out a food waste audit. The results show that a small rural school of 230 students waste over 500 kilos of food every single year. That is the problem my awesome colleague Benita here has our idea to make a change.
Thanks, Mitch. Hey guys, I'm Benita McLean, and our idea is bringing chickens into schools. Chickens teach children to become more eco-friendly. Once we get coops built into schools, people realise how much they're throwing away and the impact this has on the environment, plus ethical values as well. Then the children can go home and tell their parents about the importance of reducing food waste. The impact this will have is a behavioural change. Instead of throwing uneaten food into the landfill, people upcycle it by feeding it to chickens. So it's a win-win situation. Chickens get food in a home, and we get the eggs. Here's a quick clip from some of the children at Springston Primary School giving their thoughts on food waste.
At Springston, there's an issue with some other kids, maybe not you guys, but other children. Do you see them throwing away sandwiches and
that
stuff? What do you think their parents say when they come home? Or do you think they tell their parents?
No, they won't tell their parents.
Oh, I just ate that. Mm-hmm. I just put them.
But they've thrown it out still.
Yeah, and their parents will say, oh, good.
If we did chickens in the same kind of idea, do you see that working? Selling
eggs?
Yeah.
Selling eggs or using them, because sometimes the seniors or the little kids come
home.
Do
baking
home.
Like
yeah,
that,
like
do baking. Sometimes they do baking and they eat eggs, so maybe it might be handy for other people around the school.
The impact this will have... Oh, sorry, wrong one. We are currently setting up a coop with Springston Primary School, and all materials are being sponsored entirely by the community. It's a practical idea. It stops food going to the landfill and sustainable. Chickens lay eggs, which can be purchased by parents and teachers, and then the money made can be put back into maintenance of the chicken coop. If the chickens consume just 80% of the school's food waste, that goes a long way to reducing the 500 kilos the school produces in a year. Now we've got another clip from Alana, one of the teachers at Springston Primary School.
The students have been really great at contacting the school on a really regular basis. They've figured out what the needs were for the project. They've had a lot of work that they've done with the children. They've sourced a whole lot of materials, and they've even organised a waste survey for us. So the kids are so excited about working with these big people, and we can't wait to see our chicken coop up and the children recycling all the waste around the school and going home and pestering their parents a bit and doing it at home as well.
Thanks, Benita. Hi everyone, my name is James Fegan. The simple process of chickens laying eggs will lead to massive cultural changes. The overarching impact of our idea is to allow students to be actively involved in their learning. It gives context that teachers can use as tools in the classroom, and the food waste that students have will go towards a productive outcome instead of ending up in landfills. In the long term, by starting out at Springston Primary and gaining attention in one school, we hope to branch out to other local Canterbury schools and eventually the whole of New Zealand. By just having one coop in every school in New Zealand, we can reduce a huge amount of food wastage and teach so many students and parents about this impact. We would like to thank all the companies who have supported us by supplying us with the materials that we need to get this project operational, and all the guests organised to help us out. To our mentor, Matrice Solanke, who lives in Sydney, thank you for making the time to Skype us weekly. Also, a huge thank you to Fiona, Vic and Adrian for all they have done for us and the other scholars.
We would like to acknowledge our other team member, Jake, who unfortunately couldn't be here tonight. Search us up on Facebook to find out even more about us. And remember, Clark don't chuck.
I just really loved your name. It's so great. My question for you is, are you creating a sort of structured educational program around this, or is it more based on what the teachers are talking about with their students?
Yeah, that's right. So Alana outlined what we've been doing with the kids at school, but she's also said that they'll be working with the students in class once our track and coop is up and running at Springston Primary School. And they'll be talking about budgeting and the money that is made from selling eggs and what the kids can do with that and what it can go towards in terms of maintaining the chicken coop and what can be done with it.
So is that something then you can scale into other schools, the sort of educational material that's being created around it?
That's definitely what we're wanting to achieve, starting with our model at Springston Primary School, working to the wider Canterbury region, and obviously our main goal is to have a chicken coop in every primary school in New Zealand.
Cool. Well done.
Thank you very much.
Our next group is Survival Snacks.
Hi everyone, my name's Lauren and along with Fraser and Mackenzie, we have created the social enterprise Survival Snacks. Survival Snacks is a package of palm oil free and palm oil sustainable snack food. What we are doing is trying to encourage the consumption of these sustainable products and drive consumption away from unsustainable brands. The purpose of this is because we're trying to tackle the massive issue of deforestation. Deforestation is a massive issue as it is increasing carbon dioxide emissions as trees are burnt down to make way for palm oil plantations. It is also massively decreasing biodiversity loss of both plants and animals, such as the orangutans, tigers, elephants, and the tigers as well, as well as many other species that live in those forests. This is really sad, and at the current rate of deforestation, it could mean that orangutans are extinct in the next 5 to 10 years, meaning it is quite likely that none of us will ever see one, and especially that our kids and grandkids won't. It's also really hard for the people that live in the areas where this is taking place, as the need for the forest is removed from them. They are often forced to work in these plantations of palm oil and receive really low wages, making it really hard for them to live. This is a really big issue, but there's another issue as well, and that is that over 50% of the foods in most supermarkets contain unsustainable palm oil, and there's over 170 different labels for palm oil. This means that even if you care about the issue, and even if you know about it, it is really hard to make a change, and it's really hard to do anything about it. And that's where Survival Snacks comes in. I'll hand you over to Fraser now, who's going to talk about how we're going to make a positive impact.
Yeah, thanks, Lauren. So at Survival Snacks, we're really quite happy with our name, because it's got a kind of a double meaning. People need food, like snacks, to survive, but orangutans over in Indonesia and Malaysia also need us as consumers to choose palm oil free and palm oil sustainable in order for them to survive. Otherwise, they're just not going to have a home. That's where our product comes in. We make it a really easy alternative to all those foods that have palm oil in them by putting a bunch of palm oil free snacks, palm oil sustainable snacks in one place. So we do all the hard work. And that links into our real big selling point. We put out a survey, and one of the big responses we got back was, people really do want to shop for palm oil free food, but it's just too hard. Like Lauren said, there's so many labels. So that's what makes us attractive. We do the hard work. We put all the products in one place so the consumers get a real feel-good factor out of it without having to bust their butt off at the supermarket. And in terms of what we're hoping to achieve with this, if you look here, we've got a really nice flow-on effect. So if we start down the bottom, we get a happy customer. They consume our product, they're happy with it, and while they're eating our stuff, it means they're not buying things which have got palm oil in them. So that's going to make a bit of a business change as they see them losing a bit of money. Maybe there is a market for palm oil free foods. And so with all that, it means less palm oil is going to be consumed and onto our overarching goal, there'll be more rainforest. So those wonderful orangutans are going to have a place to live, and we can save hundreds, if not thousands of them. Even from there, there are still more effects. I'm sure you've heard of the rainforest being called the lungs of the planet. So the more the rainforest, it's like the bigger lung capacity. So the air is better, and it's just pretty much a nicer place. So that's what we're hoping to do, how we're hoping to do it, and just pass over to Mackenzie for our final thoughts.
Firstly, I'd like to invite you to like our Facebook page, Survival Snacks. And finally, I'd just like to thank everyone that helped us on the way, Vic, Fiona, Adrian, and our mentor in Sydney, Lydia, as well. And just remember, every dollar is a vote, so vote sustainably. Cheers.
I'm one of probably 200 people in the room who are very amazed to hear that 50% of foods in supermarkets have got palm oil in them and that there are 170 brands. I care about these things and I didn't know that, so thank you. That's very interesting. So as a converted customer, what's actually in these things? You know, like what are you feeding us?
Well, there are a few alternatives to palm oil.
I mean like what products? Sure.
We've got a hamper outside, so if you come and see us afterwards, it's got a whole big whatever's in it. One of the real good ones is Mother Earth, that we like to half on about them and promote them. They're really, really good. So they're usually bars and that kind of thing.
Nice. And so you've obviously been engaging with a bunch of brands who are explicitly trying to be palm oil. How's that process gone for you? What's your approach been?
Oh, that's just at the stage we're up to now. We're just getting in touch with people now to see if they're interested in being our supplier for that kind of thing, and we can promote them as we're getting their product further to maybe a market they wouldn't usually reach, and also just paints them in a really good light. So, that's what we're doing with that.
Nice.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Our final group before intermission is Global Lincoln Experience.
A quote from a Lincoln student: Kiwis for Kiwis, internationals for internationals. Hello to all. I'm Chloe, and alongside my teammate Maddie, we have created Global Lincoln Experience. Unfortunately, Maddie cannot be here tonight as she is currently studying in Norway, lucky for some, but she is watching on Skype. Lincoln University has 68% domestic and 32% international students. How many of these domestic students are friends with any of the international students? Sadly, only around 37%. We have students that travel from all ends of the globe. They come to Lincoln University to not only obtain a top tertiary education, but to experience everything that New Zealand and the university have to offer. After all, Lincoln is the New Zealand of New Zealand. When paying up to $40,000 each year, we think they deserve more than just study and accommodation, but are they getting it? It is obvious, just when walking around the campus, that there is a division. The internationals are in one area and the domestic are in another. This means students are missing out on amazing cultural and social experiences that all lead to fulfilling their university life. After years of studying, a student should leave with fond memories made of new lifelong friends. Rather than feelings of regret, or feeling isolated and lonely in class, too afraid to contribute to a class discussion, or not going to watch a big sports game because they didn't know the rules and were unsure of the environment. These are not just made-up scenarios, but are real feelings expressed from some of our very own international students. Sadly, this problem is not just isolated to Lincoln, but is a common problem amongst universities. As you can tell from my accent, I am not from New Zealand. Although I am a domestic student, I can relate to struggling to fit into a new environment in a foreign country miles away from home. But Global Lincoln Experience isn't just focused on what our international students are missing out on, but what our domestic students are too. Many Lincoln graduates will be involved in international business in the future. Our multicultural campus could not offer a more perfect setting for students to make great connections that could prove invaluable in their future careers. However, as of yet, many domestic students are not making the most of this opportunity, and therefore not giving their careers the very best possible start they so easily can. Our idea to get rid of this problem is to integrate all students at university. Our idea is to hold a variety of social events throughout the year that focus and promote and support inclusion of all. In order for our events to be made possible, we will require a small donation per student. We will use this money to help cover any possible venue hire and discounted food and drink, because who doesn't like a discount? We will also look at getting sponsorship from local businesses. So we will bring them customers and they will give us deals. To encourage students to maintain their new friendships, we will have a free monthly get-together that just gives students the chance to have a catch-up. I carried out a survey to see if students liked our idea. 71% of domestic and 75% of international students said they felt there was a divide here at Lincoln. Of the same students, I asked them what they thought of our events. 68% of domestic and 79% of international students said they would like to be involved in our events. We are sure that Global Lincoln Experience has the potential to not only enhance, but to improve student life. Encouraging and facilitating student interaction, embracing and accepting new cultures, and increasing internal connections on campus, all which lead to creating a friendlier, more inviting environment for all. For domestic students, it's the chance to make ties and connections that they can call upon in their future roles, whether that be when they're on a business trip in America and need somewhere to stay, or someone that can help explain how to use public transport in China, because let's be honest, public transport is a bit foreign to New Zealanders. And then there is Lincoln University as a whole that will benefit. Increasing the relationships between individuals will lead to alumni getting a more enriched international experience. If international alumni can see that our project is having a positive contribution to universities in New Zealand, we are optimistic in seeing our ideas being adopted by universities overseas. Our aspirations for our project do not just stop at the university gate. We can see this project going as far as having a positive impact on New Zealand's economy. Connections between individuals all around the world will increase internal diplomatic relations, which can assist with international business in the future. Global Lincoln Experience is committed to breaking down the barriers. It's just about making that first crucial step. Maddie and I are just two university students that want to make a change for future generations. We already have the backing of each other, our mentors, Vic and Dee, and the very individuals that matter the most, the students. But the icing on the cake would be to have your backing too. Thank you for listening.
Thank you for your presentation. One of my research areas is social capital and immigration, so it's great to see that you are thinking about it. Given your survey and your experience in exploring this project, what do you think is the biggest barrier for cross-group networks?
I think from our survey, it showed that it's the cultures, the difference in cultures is the biggest problem, and especially for international students, because coming from a country that's totally different to New Zealand, they come over here and everything's so foreign, and they're, because they don't know anyone, they're too afraid to branch out and get involved. So that's where our ideas come in to key, because we want to break down those barriers and make them realize that we're not scary, you know. Yeah.
That's fantastic. But if you arrange a get together, or you talked about different events, and if there is a dominant group, it's always natural for human beings to tend to interact with people they have similarities with. So did you think about how would you facilitate those kind of events so that students are engaged?
Yeah, so through our surveys, we asked students what they would like to get involved in. So one of the big things was rugby. The international students would like to learn about rugby, and a lot of domestic students love rugby. So that's a really good event, because the domestic students would love to teach students about rugby, and the international students want to learn. So we thought that was a really good way to bring them together.
Excellent idea. Thank you.
Thank you.
And our first group after the break is GMO the Go?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Sam Wilson, and this is Braden Schroeder.
Thank you, Sam. We plan to play our part in the future global food shortage. By 2050, it is expected to have about almost just over 9 billion people on Earth. This is because of the future, this is because of the current population growth rates. The UN state that we will require 60% more food to feed this future population. Taking into account that there will also be increased urbanisation and therefore less productive land. So how are we going to produce 60% more food to feed this future population? How are we going to produce that 60% more, and how are consumer choices going to impact this future demand? And how much are the media going to impact these future consumer choices? So, is GMO the go?
Braden and myself, as co-founders of Is GMO the Go, along with other organisations now by our side, are investigating whether GMO is the answer to the issue Braden has just stated.
Right. I would like you all to think carefully about this. Please raise your hand if you are 100% sure that you have not consumed GE or any GMO ingredients within the last 48 hours. There we go. Look around, everyone. The majority of you realise that there are so much more GMO or GE ingredients on our shelves here in New Zealand, or you may just be unaware, just like myself and Sam were not too long ago. The way the New Zealand law currently stands, that genetically engineered ingredients can still find their way into our food chain. We, Sam and I, at Team Is GMO the Go, believe you as consumers deserve the right to know what is in the food that you are consuming, and in turn putting into your bodies. Q, our idea's purpose for providing you as the consumers the opportunity to make your own unbiased, informed decisions around the science of GMO. Via our fun, simple to use, trendy app Is GMO the Go.
Our app will provide the supply chain information when you scan a product in the supermarket. Our app will also provide the level of safety testing which has been carried out, and we're working with the Centre of Food Safety to gather this vital information. Our app will educate you around the topic of GMO, as we believe we shouldn't bash GMO, we should investigate. We're also working with a company, Palm Oil Investigation, who have a similar app to us, but when you scan their app, it tells you the amount of palm oil in the product. We have many niche ideas to help create a point of difference with our app. One of these is have a locator, so when you, the consumer, walk into a supermarket, you'll get a notification reminding you to use our app.
We've carried out some research this year at Lincoln University, approved by the Human Ethics Committee. We used Lincoln University students, as we found that they are the future generation that we will target our app to. We found that with almost 700 participants in our survey, that 75% of the students would use our app. We asked, would you purchase food that is genetically modified, and found that 62% of people would. 68% of people would purchase it if it was on special, and 76% of people would purchase it if it had added nutritional value. This last paragraph shows that all of you, as consumers, as a whole, are not one-sided along the topic of GMO. That is why Sam and I also have a neutral perspective in terms of GMO, as we believe that it could be part of the answer in feeding this future population. But only if sufficient safety testing is carried out and approved to be safe for human consumption and cause no negative environmental impacts on the environment. Our app can help play a part in solving this future food shortage by educating the future generations about the possible consequences and benefits of GMO products and introducing it into a country. Some possible benefits to GMO could be the new ryegrass strain that could potentially come into New Zealand one day, or the white Angus cattle breed that is genetically modified to cope better with heat stress, or even in Bangladesh, the new eggplant that has BT bacterial gene injected into it to allow for better survival rates and better or less use for fungicides. some consequences we some may be aware of are the known glyphosate residuals found in Roundup Ready crops. But it's known that, or it's believed more likely, that it can cause microbiome negative impacts to our human body. We're asking you today and looking for assistance with the legalities around sourcing the data for our app. We are also looking, as we are currently working with our app developer, and we require $10,000 to get this app fully up and running and developed. We also require $850 per month for the support and marketing and hosting of the app after we get it up and running in early 2018.
See, even Uncle Sam agrees with our future generation that this app will allow you to make informed decisions around the science of GMO, as we strongly believe
that you deserve the right to know.
You did a really great job of getting 700 students to respond to a survey. Well done.
Thank you.
My question is, you've given some numbers around what it's going to cost. Have you thought about how you're going to make money and fund that and fund it ongoing?
Yeah, so an ongoing cost, to start off, we hope to have that the funding to start off the app, obviously in the development, but as it's a sustainable business model, we hope to be able to create our own income source from users on the app to provide the information, and hopefully people will pay for that. So as a start, we hope to put a cost on the app, but eventually when we have an up and running, provide a free app, and so we can provide that crucial information at a free cost, as we do need to also be sustainable in the terms of the app. Cheers.
Our next group is Jump Frog.
So, we want you all to remember back to your primary school days. Maybe a long time for some, but we want you to remember back anyway. What were your favourite parts about school? Playing indoors or playing outside?
When you were outside, could you reach the top of the playground? Could you finish a game of footy? Could you go on the flying fox or the rock wall?
Was your favourite game tag or jump rope? Could you keep up with your mates? Think about your fitness. Were you fit enough to complete these activities?
Now we want you to double your body weight as a child. Has your lifestyle changed? Are you able to keep up with your mates? Do you still even want to play outside?
This is New Zealand's future if we don't make a change. Already, over 33% of kids in New Zealand are classed overweight or obese.
What has been done? So far, only compulsory PE classes of 20 minutes four times a week have been implemented. So you now ask, fitness is covered, so why are children still obese? It must be the food, right? Oh, it's because we don't have a sugar tax. It's the government's fault.
No, it's actually our fault. As a generation educating these kids and parents, we have let them down. We need to stop shifting the blame and start making the impact.
We, Ashley, Christian and Heidi, are here to bring you Jump Frog. In collaboration with Sport New Zealand nutritionists and personal trainers, we have designed a three-dimensional platform which incorporates education, food and fitness. The aim of the app is for children and students to work out, make recipes or do educational quizzes where they earn points. These points will coincide into an avatar world where they can update their lifestyles through changing hair colours, changing clothes, etc.
You may be thinking, where is our proof? How is an app going to change obesity? We now ask you this question. Think of all the children you know. What do they know most about? Most probably technology. As technology grows, so does the knowledge children gain around it. Therefore, we believe technology is the only way to reach the new generation.
Take Pokemon Go as an example. It exploded. It got people outside and being active. Probably not in the safest way, but it worked. Also, fundraisers such as Steptember, which aims to get people to take 10,000 steps this month of September to raise money and awareness for cerebral palsy. Through an app, they count the number of steps you take each day, which goes to show that an app really is a great way to reach the people.
The evidence that an app can influence the behaviours of people to lose weight is all over the web.
According to Sport NZ, children need that extra incentive, hence the point system to lose, hence the point system, as they don't have the motivation to lose weight like adults do. We have ensured credibility by working with nutritionists and personal trainers to make sure it's safe for kids.
We've discussed your idea with the local community. We asked them, are you interested in an app? Do you think it would help obesity? However, we did have negative feedback. They didn't understand how an app could help obesity. However, once we explained the whole process, the whole motivation behind the app, they then realised that it can actually work. The questions changed to how can we get this, when is it going to be ready, and how much will it cost us?
We did come across some problems along the way, such as the cost of making an app. Also, we realised that not all kids have internet access or mobile devices at home. This is why we created our Facebook page, Jump Frog LU, where we upload videos and recipes each week. We also have a short-term goal of creating a website with exercise on it so that the kids can access this at school.
We would like to thank you all for listening today. We do hope that you share in the same goal as us, as reducing obesity in New Zealand, because it isn't New Zealand's future. We're supposed to be active and healthy. We'll finish off with a short clip, which is supposed to inspire children to get active.
Bet you had fun making those videos. Oh, we have to go surfing today, damn. Hey, cool challenge, guys. This is a busy market, isn't it? I mean, it's like you said, it's a huge problem, no pun intended. And it's awesome that you've been engaging with nutritionists and personal, some people just got the joke, that was terrible. It's awesome that you've been engaging with nutritionists and personal trainers. So their initial feedback was hesitant, is that what you're saying?
No, the communities, like as in taking it to parents and children, they were a bit hesitant because they didn't understand technology is supposed to... Well, traditionally technology keeps children inside, doesn't it? TV, PlayStation, all that sort of thing. But our app's designed for them to get active and get outside. So once we'd explained the whole process, they changed their thoughts to more positive ones, positive really, yeah.
No, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Well done.
Cool. Thanks.
Excellent. Our next group is Know What You Eat.
Cool. So, Know What You Eat. That sounds pretty simple. You know what you're putting in your mouth each day, don't you? Well, we believe in our modern world. Answering yes to this is getting a little bit more uncertain. So, my name's Brittany, and alongside my teammates Nick and Will, we are Know What You Eat. We have identified a major issue with conscious consumerism in our societies. Basically, due to increasing urban population and the ability to import food, we don't really know where our food's coming from anymore, and we don't know where it was produced. We simply put it on our plate, and we eat it. Access to food in the last 50 years has changed significantly, and the journey that it goes through to reach your plate is also changing. But through all this development, the one thing that hasn't changed is the level of education, and now it's lagging behind. Consumers have become disjointed from what they're up to and what they're eating. We believe this is partly to blame with urban population growing, and you simply go to the mall, go to the supermarket, and you buy all your food from one source. This doesn't leave much room for variety or education. Don't even get me started on those ingredients lists which have the numbers and the chemicals and... It's not English, and let's be fair, none of us actually understand it. It's quite confusing. So, what we're really worried about is the environment and the effect that their unconscious consumerism is having worldwide. So to talk more about what we want to accomplish and what we're actually up to, I'll hand you over to Nick.
Thanks, Brittany. We've looked into five specific ways in which unconscious consumerism is a problem, and we look to address this problem. Sustainability of food and its food security is looking, we need to be sustained. Sustainability of our food supplies and food security needs to be maintained for future generations to come. Food miles and its effect on the environment. Food miles has a big effect on the environment, and it usually comes at the cost of the Earth's atmosphere. Seasonality is all about consuming locally, decreasing food miles, and supporting local producers and economies. The more you know about your food, where it comes from, and the effect you have on the environment as a consumer will turn you into a social, will turn you into a conscious consumer, And that'll have a positive effect on your well-being. We aim to have an educational purpose through the use of a social media, a website, and eventually an app. We are currently on social media with a Facebook page and a Twitter page, as it connects people and it gives them the opportunity to connect with people and unite to solve problems that concern them. To further explain our process and what we've achieved, here's Will.
Thanks, Nate. In a need to know more about conscious consumerism, food miles, and sustainability, we have done large amounts of research into not only these issues, but also the issues that concern others. We put together a survey which asked a multitude of questions. These questions focused mainly on fresh produce. People have become incredibly ignorant to the fact that fresh produce isn't simply grown year-round in New Zealand, as they just go to the supermarket and buy what's on the shelf. Because of this, we decided that educating about seasonality was the best way of getting consumers to know more about their seasonality issues. And a simple way to communicate our message of seasonality was to display posters like this around supermarkets. This will help consumers get the knowledge they need to make educated decisions when buying products. This will hopefully decrease food miles, limit greenhouse gases, and help support local economies. To talk about the future of our idea, here's Brittany.
So there's a lot of possibilities. Obviously, we're in the aim of education. We really want to accomplish this through the use of an app. We think that an app is a great way to display information to consumers where they can learn what they want to know and change their consumption as to what worries them. Issues such as seasonality, sustainability, food miles, imports, and what effect that those imports are having on the environment and the world around them. This also gives our idea the ability to go global, which is kind of half the point. So I think by now you know that we care, but for those of you who don't, here's why you really should. We can no longer pass the blame onto the businesses who have the negative impacts. It's our consumption and our demand that drives that. So really, it's us that has to make the change. So why don't we all take a step towards education? Remember, change actually starts with education. So if you have any questions, comments, just feel like a bit of a chat, we're outside near the stairs, or you can always get in contact with us on our social media. Thanks, guys.
Thank you for a good presentation. One of the things that would, something that you'd face when you go to the more full-fledged project, I think, is when you think about the supermarket food, they are sometimes, most of the times, cheaper than the locally grown organic food. So if we think that organic food is something that you propose for, and
it would have an impact on the certain segment of population where affordability would become a major issue. How would you address that?
Well, part of the real problem is that, especially in New Zealand with our duopoly of supermarkets, fresh produce growers are actually backed into a corner and they have to start accepting prices lower than what they would, meaning their profit margins are very small. So eventually part of our idea could be connecting local growers with local consumers, decreasing the price because it's coming straight from the grower. The supermarket isn't taking their cut, and that further supports local economy, decreases food miles, and all the effects that will have.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next group is Positive Profit.
Four million hectares of tropical rainforest has been cleared in the last 20 years. Under 400 Sumatran tigers are left on this earth. 100,000 school kids deprived of their education because the air is too polluted to breathe. 150 indigenous Indonesians mysteriously murdered due to human trafficking. Do you know what is producing all of these horrific stats? Unsustainable palm oil production. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As you can now see, we have a huge problem on our hands that is not going to fix itself. So that's where we come in, Positive Profit. Hugh Luffman, Alexia Ma and myself will enlighten you on what the big fuss about palm oil is, what we're going to do about it, and how we know that we're not the only ones who care. Palm oil is an edible vegetable oil that is derived from the mesocarp of the fruit from oil palms. Due to its extreme versatility, it is found in everything from soap to biofuel to animal feeds. But more importantly, it is found in over 50% of all processed products on supermarket shelves. So when you brush your teeth at night, when you enjoy that chocolatey treat, when you take that hard-earned shower, and when you eat any of 50% of processed products on supermarket shelves, you are more than likely consuming palm oil. Do these facts surprise you? Because by hell, they alarm us. Hugh, are we the only ones who care?
Thanks, Henry. Well, let's find out. We've collected a lot of information about to see how palm oil awareness being in products is affecting or would affect consumer habits. Our first question found that found that the majority of people are aware of the environmental effects of palm oil. Our second question found that even though the majority of people are aware of the effects Henry has outlined, 72% do not know that palm oil is in many of our supermarket products, labelled under hundreds of different names, such as these, which are very hard to recognise. Many companies use these names to hide the fact that they are selling us unsustainable palm oil. So we posed our third question, which asked, if palm oil-free products were clearly labelled as being so and obvious to find, would you shop palm oil-free? And this answers Henry's original question. Yes, people do care, as 86% of respondents said they would shop palm oil-free if labelling was clear, simple and easy to find. So that's where our plan comes in.
Our first step is to raise awareness surrounding the issue of palm oil and its unsustainable productions. We intend to do a lot of this through our Facebook page, Positive Profit, as it is a really useful outlet to instantly share related articles and findings with like-minded people all over the world. There are many examples of how social media campaigns have influenced change, and we will use this to our advantage to continue to raise awareness surrounding the issue of unsustainable palm oil. It is important that we begin networking with New Zealand companies who are either palm oil free or use 100% certified sustainable palm oil to create a positive relationship where they will want to work with us to be a part of the movement towards the clearer labelling of palm oil. Our third step is to create Positive Profit, an organisation where we aim to promote the use of good palm oil, where the people, biodiversity and land all profit positively. We've designed two logos which are simple and easy to recognise, which represents Positive Profit and the biodiversity which should be flourishing instead of being continually cleared for unsustainable palm oil production. These logos will be a measurable tool to show companies there is a real demand and real profit to be made by committing to 100% certified sustainable traceable palm oil. One logo is a palm oil free logo, only to be used when a company is entirely palm oil free. The other is a 100% certified sustainable palm oil logo, where a brand commits to only using 100% traceable palm oil. For a reasonable cost, the logos will be sold to New Zealand companies who we have networked with for them to include on the packaging of their products for easy recognition by consumers. The cost of the logos will be used to cover annual website costs, logo trademarking, as well as continuous research into making sure companies continue to use 100% certified sustainable palm oil. Our impact is that positive profit logos will become familiar to consumers, so they know that when they buy a positive profit certified product, they are buying with confidence, knowing that they are voting through their money to join positive profit in the 100% certified sustainable palm oil movement.
Whitakers New Zealand and EcoStore have already expressed interest in positive profit, so we are asking you to flick over to Facebook, give us a like, and show that you support us and other businesses that are creating a positive profit. Thank you.
So my question is, who do you think is going to be the hardest sell? Is it going to be getting companies to use your logo, or is it going to be getting customers recognizing it for what it is?
I think the main problem initially is probably getting customers to recognize it. Like Henry said, we've got Whitaker's EcoStore, and we've talked to a lot of other businesses who are already palm oil free, who are keen to do something like this. But eventually we want it to be sort of like the Heart Foundation tip or something like that, which is everyone knows about, it's instantly recognisable. So once we got a few businesses on board, then people will start to recognise it, and hopefully other businesses would change how they use palm oil. Yeah, thanks.
Our next group is Ready, Steady, Grow.
Hi everyone, my name is Jess and I will be speaking on behalf of my group tonight alongside James and Kate. As many of you are probably aware, the world's population is growing exponentially. We are currently at 7.4 billion people, going to reach 8 billion in 8 years and pass the 10 billion mark by 2056. This is all going to be our problem to deal with the consequences of this. These are the years that me, my mum and my nana were born. Can anyone in the audience take a guess at what the population was in 1937?
4 billion.
Not quite, it was only 2.3 billion. By the time my mum was born, it had reached 3.8, and by the time I was born, it was 5.8. And this shows that over my nana's lifetime, the world population has increased by 5.2 billion people. Also in 1937, the urban population was only at 490 million. By the time my mum was born, it was 1.4 billion, and by the time I was born, it had reached 2.6 billion, which is showing that population growth is having an effect on urbanisation. Population growth is also having a domino effect on many social and environmental issues. As mentioned in the last slide, urbanisation is increasing, which means that cities are expanding. Alongside this, food demand is increasing, and food demand is going to increase by 70% by 2050. So how are we going to feed everyone? Well, currently, one of the best solutions that we use is intensive agriculture. However, intensive agriculture degrades the quality of the land, and these are only some of the effects. So we are then going to hit a brick wall, because the quality of land is going to degrade the yields anyway. So the question that we asked ourselves was, how do we decrease food demand without using any more land? And this was the main idea behind our project. We thought that the best way to approach this was not by changing people's habits that already exist, but by introducing new habits to children that they haven't yet developed. If children grow up used to growing their own food, it will become the norm to them, and the hope is that it is a value they will continue to do throughout the rest of their lives. I have to admit that I don't actually grow my own food. This is mainly because I'm a student and I'm always moving around, but as a kid, I wasn't really taught how to grow anything either, and I was always scared to give it a go in case I killed everything. So the more I've been looking into it, the more I feel confident in being able to pick it up easy enough, and the grandparents are always a good place to start. So our project is to create a business that sells a lifelong activity book to children that includes instructions, hints, challenges, recipes, and a diary so that they can learn everything they need to know about growing their own food. I feel like not growing food myself actually gives us an advantage in creating this, as I need to be able to follow the book easily too, and I understand what they don't know. In the recent holidays, I went along to the garden club at Pembroke Primary School in Oamaru. And these were some of our findings. I also found that the kids aged 5 and 6 tended to just copy what the older kids did. And they also couldn't understand some basic concepts, such as putting one seed in a hole and covering it up. Instead, it was just tip the packet everywhere and smother the soil around. So from this information, I feel like basing our book around the children of ages 8 to 12 is probably going to be best. And our instructions need to be based on fast-growing food so that they don't lose interest. Garden to Table is already a major contributor in this area. They're a schools-based program who require community support and use an online membership fee for this. So for us to add something a little bit extra, we need to have a point of difference. So for us to do that, we want to have a low-cost book that is individual-based. If it's individual-based, they can take it home and be self-sufficient, and they don't need schools to be involved, as schools can be busy enough. It will be localised in Christchurch initially, and all of the profits will be reinvested back into the business. The next step for us is to continue the research of the content of our book. We will engage with children more so that we can find out what they would want in a book. We will then find a publisher and publish it, and we will trial our books with Lincoln Primary School, as they have agreed to let us do so. We will then sell the book as an individual product, and all going well, the profits will be reinvested back into the business to expand in the future. We have been lucky enough to have Glenn Whisker as a mentor for us. In 1999, he created this book here under the brand Earth's Own. However, as he was too busy, this book isn't up and running anymore. However, his knowledge has been a great asset to us, and we have the book on our table way down the other end of the foyer if you would like to come and have a look. Thank you all for coming, and I hope you've enjoyed your night.
We're only allowed one question, so we're just conversing. How do you choose the foods that you're going to... I mean, you've talked about the fast-growing stuff, but in terms of being able to go right through to the food preparation and all that sort of stuff, the recipes... How does that process work, selecting which things you're going to grow?
I guess that's just going to come into us researching more and getting out there, talking to kids, what would they want to grow, what do they find the yummiest, because if they're going to be using recipes to make the food, they're going to want to eat it as well. So we'll just continue engaging with children, finding out what they would want, get them excited about it, and then base all of the content of our book on them.
Cool.
Thank you.
And our lucky last group for tonight is Decline the Pine.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Rupert Power, and along with my colleague, Gemma Harnett, we are team Decline the Pine. This national problem of wilding pine control personally affected me 10 years ago when my family bought our farm in the Mackenzie Basin. Back then, the problem of wilding pines was not known. Through future development and knowledge, it has become eradication has become a more and more of a problem. Seen here. Educate to eradicate. It's as simple as that. Provide New Zealanders with the information and guidance to easily eradicate and undertake volunteer wilding pine control. If action is not taken, this could happen. 20% of New Zealand could be invaded with wilding pines in the next 20 years. That is 5.4 million hectares. Today's eradication solutions include commercial and volunteer work. Commercial includes trained and employed volunteers. Funding is from the government and landowners, and it is run by with the intention for profit. Volunteer groups are undertaken voluntary. There's no financial assistance undertaken, and they are run by a group of passionate people. Improvements need to be made to increase voluntary impacts. More manpower is required. New Zealanders aren't aware of the impact that wilding pines actually have on the environment and flora and fauna. It outcompetes everything. There is no user-friendly technology out there to bring like-minded people and New Zealanders together to have an influence and attack this problem. That is where our solution comes into play. We have a fun, interactive app that provides people with information and communication to get involved with volunteer activities within New Zealand. It is simple and easy. How it works is a large interactive map where people can click on pinpoints where they are interested or close by. From this, they can click going if they want more information. From this, they can find where the event is, where they can meet, what is required of them, and the experience and difficulty of the landscape of which the voluntary area is undertaken. And if further information is required, they can find that on the app. Awesome features. It is interactive, it is educational, and it is simple and easy.
It's as simple as a pair of loppers, a pair of gloves, good footwear, a high vis, and a sun hat. Simple and easy.
Thanks, Rupert. So, who can get involved? You can. It's as easy as 5 steps. Simply download our fun, simple-to-use app, select a location close to your area, select, apply, and get involved. As a volunteer, you will be required to bring a sun hat, a pair of loppers, gloves, a high vis, good footwear, and a good attitude. Back to you, Rupert.
Thank you, Gemma. So, social media. It is so important in our lives today, and we want to use it to bring people together. We want to make it fun, and we want to see what others are doing around New Zealand with the same attitude. By doing so, it communicates and educates people. So follow us on Facebook and see where we go next. Our roadmap from here. I will introduce us here to you tonight. From this, we are going to communicate with volunteer groups and commercial groups to furthermore our idea with our app. And then from that, go through partnerships with Department of Conservation and council groups, and council, local and national as well, with the idea to then design and create the app from this point with their help and guidance. From that, pre-release, launch and decline the pine. So people, let's make New Zealand great again. Thank you.
Last questions. And good presentation. Have you been talking to, so you said that you have spoken to the volunteer groups and you have spoken to the council. What has been the response from their side?
They love the idea, the effect of bringing people together, like-minded people together from, because there's already a lot of voluntary groups all around New Zealand, and they're all split up. They don't really relate with each other. We've got Wakatipu, Mackenzie, Castle Hill, that sort of area. And the idea is to bring them together into this one sort of app where they can work together and they can say, we're having an area here, we're in the Mackenzie Basin, and bring people from different areas into this area. And the idea of going into a new landscape, seeing different areas, seems to enthuse people a bit more. And in relation to council and Department of Conservation, they have the positive idea of getting pines on the ground is what they like. With Department of Conservation, that's their big idea, and anything they can help with that is even more of a benefit as well. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, well, that concludes the presentation part of our evening. So I want you to join me in giving a wonderful hand to our great Global Challenge scholars. I think I can speak on behalf of all involved in this how immensely proud we are of them, not just for the wonderful presentation skills that they've shown tonight, but also all the hard work that they've put in since February on these projects, keeping in mind that these projects have been undertaken in addition to their normal university studies and their probably quite wide-ranging university lives as well too. So well done, guys. Okay, before we announce the prizes, there's many, many thank yous that we have to hand out for tonight and indeed for the many months that our Global Challenge scholars have been working on their projects. First of all, we want to really give a big thank to the mentors for all these groups. Not just Fiona, Victorian and Adrian here, but also the mentors around the world who've given up their time to mentor and help train our wonderful Global Challenge scholars. So a big thank you to those mentors. I also wanted to point out that we're still on the lookout for more mentors. This is a program that we'll be running into the future here at Lincoln University. So if anyone is interested or knows of someone who might be interested in acting as a mentor for future groups, please do get in contact with us because we'd love to hear from you and we'd love to help you, or allow you to help mentor the next batch of Global Challenge scholars. So please keep that in mind. Next, I wanted to thank our three wonderful judges. So could you please give a big round of applause to Nasmin, Jason, and Anna. Now there's a bunch of people who've made this event tonight work really, really well. And we want to thank the Lincoln University staff, but in particular the events team, Shona and Lauren, who I think are lurking outside at the moment. I also wanted to give a really, really big thank you to our Lincoln Connect team, particularly our Schools Link team, headed up by Fiona Scott over here. And ably assisted by Adrian. And Victoria. So it was these guys who ran with this program and got our Global Challenge scholars working on all these different projects, guided them all the way, cajoled them when they needed to, were shoulders to cry on when that was needed as well too, and they've done a fantastic job. I also wanted to thank, particularly because he's come all the way from Wellington, Jeremy Baker, who's a former Deputy Vice Chancellor here at Lincoln University. The Global Challenge program is Jeremy's baby. So back when he was Deputy Vice Chancellor, this was one of the wonderful things that he set up. And these 12 groups are a wonderful legacy to that program. So thanks very much, Jeremy. Rightio, let's hear about some prizes, shall we? Okie doke.
Thank you, MC. Done a good job.
Oh, no, thanks. Okay, so our People's Choice Award, who are going to go to Wellington for a day under the wonderful tutelage of Anna, is Positive Profit. So it was a very tight decision, the judges tell me, as to who was their overall winner. I first wanted to mention a highly commended, which we don't have a thing for, but we'll show our appreciation to them via applause, and that is Count Your Chickens. And finally, our group that's going to Sydney for 2 days to get mentoring in social entrepreneurship is Ready, Steady, Grow. Hopefully, while those guys are over there, they can do what Count Your Chickens suggested, and that's teach the Australians how to play rugby. For those who don't know, I'm a long-suffering Wallaby supporter. Okay, so the judges explained to me what it was that made them choose Ready, Steady, Grow as their winners. And they mentioned that what they liked about their project was that it had a clear product with clear connections to people who would help them implement it, and it identified an obvious way that it could actually solve the problem that they were aiming to achieve. So once again, a big round of applause for Ready, Steady, Grow. So almost finally, I wanted to thank all of you for coming tonight. I know some of you have travelled quite a long way to support either friends and family and support our scholars, and many of you have sort of come to sort of see what this Changemaker series is all about. So we really, really thank your participation and appreciate you coming here and having input. So thanks a lot. Second to last, but not least, a big round of applause again for our Global Challenge Scholars. And then finally, I'm going to hand over to Jamie, who's going to very briefly fill you on the next event in our Changemaker series.
Thanks, Tim. I'm going to formally thank you, since we're doing thanking. So thank you for your MC duties. Very much appreciated. Okay. Our Changemaker series has been running all year and it's been really, really successful. We can fill this room quite well with people that are interested in some of the topics. And you'll notice in your book we've actually got the name of our next series that you might, or the next session you might be interested in. The title is What's Eating All of Our Potatoes? So if you're interested and you want to come along, it's in this room, it's on the 6th of October. Like I said, it is in your book. So feel free to have a look at that. If you have any questions about it, find a friendly staff member and we'll give you more information. But just to finish up, thank you for coming. Like we've said, we hope you enjoyed. This is an inaugural event and we were really excited to bring it to you. So enjoy. Thank you.